so much for all coming out on this cold day for these wonderful instructions. It's amazing for me to be back here, where indeed I presented really one of the earliest iterations of this project. And really a huge honor for me to be alongside Don Flemons here. As we'll talk about tonight, we actually have been in communication and conversation for quite a while, and so it's a real pleasure to be able to do this. But we are going to do a lot of some singing, talking, showing of historical documents, and mix this all together. But there's going to be a lot of banjo, so get ready, you are forewarned. We're going to start with a song.
No, that's not the start. Good evening, everyone. Well, I'll start off with a number here that really, this was a number that really brought the idea of the Africanized banjo into my wheelhouse. You know, when I first started playing, I was into a lot of different types of folk music, and the banjo wasn't necessarily associated with African American culture as I was studying it at first. But of course, the event that Laurent and I met at, the Black Banjo Gathering, which happened in 2005. It was one of the first events to bring all these different factions of banjo study together, because everybody had been in their own little worlds of how they handled looking at the banjo, because it's gone through so many iterations, which Laurent will be so much more eloquent in describing all these iterations. And for me, I was drawn to these singers called songsters, and of course I took the moniker of the American songster. And these songsters were kind of on the periphery, so when I got into blues music, country blues music, there were these singers that played more than just blues. They played like folk songs, and they played dance tunes and whatnot, and one of those musicians was Henry Ragtime Texas Thomas, and I'm going to play you one of his. So he featured an instrument called the quills, and since we're talking about the Caribbean, we don't really know where he got his quills from, but it definitely has an international flavor in American music in a very unique way. And so he was one of three people to record with this instrument that had links back to the antebellum days, but he was the only one to make commercial records. So this is an old square dance number called Charmin' Betsy. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, as Dom said, we first met at this Black Banjo Gathering, which was the most significant academic conference ever to be held because it led to the creation of the Carolina Chocolate Trust, who have, in a lot of ways, transformed the way that people think about the banjo. I think that's really vital. And one of the things we want to talk about in the foreground is there's an important politics to how we think about this instrument. There's a symbolism to this instrument that's been so rich in American culture. And that's part of what I try to explore in the book, is how and why this has been such a symbol. I'm going to talk more today about the early emergence of the banjo. There's obviously a lot to discuss too about its later iterations, minstrelsy, and all these forms, and we can talk about those. But I want to start with actually the question that a lot of people ask when they first encounter banjo for the first time, which is the kind of questions that structured my book. The first is, what is that thing? Right? It's a very strange looking instrument if you think about it. Maybe many of you have seen it before, but the first time you encounter it, it's quite a contraption. The second question people ask is, where did it come from, right? Why is it here? And also, why does it keep making that noise? Right? It's a constant question. So I want to try to ask those. The first question really went in asking the very first question, which is like, what is a banjo? Banjos have been built in lots of shapes and sizes with different necks and four strings and five strings and a short top string. There's a lot of variety. But what I come down with in the book, what I argue in the book, is that the one thing you really have to have a banjo is the skin, an animal skin over the resonator, right? That is what distinguishes this instrument from other string instruments. And it's kind of the key to understanding its history. As you heard, this is kind of important because when a drum head resonates, it's not just something you hear, it's something you kind of feel, right, like a drum. And that is part of what the sonic experience of hearing a banjo is, I think, what's kind of drawn people to it. So there are some musicians actually who use the drum head pretty strongly, right? Like Hobart Smith has a kind of a tune that he plays where he hits it, and some players really hit it as a drum in a certain way.
Yeah, that was actually something that drew me to the instrument originally. You know, even before I knew that it had African antecedents and that there was such a deep history. As I started out playing music, I was in the school band and I played percussion. And one of the things that drew me to the banjo, I had started playing the guitar by that point, but it drew me to the fact that it was like a drum in certain ways, you know. Being able to play just being able to have that sort of power, taking the ideas I'd learned from doing rudiments on the drum and being able to create chord shapes and create this very unique rhythmic tone. And then, of course, the banjo has such drive to it naturally that, as a 16-year-old, that drew me in as well. I said, yeah, ba-da-da-da-da-da, you know, and just did all sorts of stuff with that. But, the instrument's great for that, just to... Because the first time I went to the Black Banjo Gathering, I met two wonderful musicians from Africa. One, Daniel Jota from the Gambia, and he played an instrument called the akonting, which is an instrument that has three strings on it, so one short string and two long strings. And at that time, it was the first time that it was he and another fellow, Ulf Jongfers. They had done research to show that this was the actual instrument, or at least the great-great-grandfather of the banjo. There was another fellow by the name of Sheikh Amala Jabate, who lives out of Washington, D.C., and he plays an instrument called the ngone. Did anybody happen to see the new version of Roots? So, the early parts of it, the banjo and the African stringed instrument, that's Sheikh Amala Jabate. He's the actual guy who played it. There's also a scene where Forrest Whitaker's walking around with this little instrument for a second, and that's actually Sheikh's ngone there. And, it was funny because I'd seen it so many times.
just knowing Shake, I was like, oh, what are they doing with Shake's instrument in his hand? You know, they incorporate it into the story. So, but the dichotomy of, again, this is why the Black Banjo Gathering was such an important event. See, the Compton is a folk instrument. And so for Daniel, he learned the stories of how, well, the elders used to say, don't practice your accompting by the water because the devils may take you. And there was a folkloric story that when the accompting players would be out, you know, near the water playing their accompting, they would disappear all of a sudden. And then they would have these strange footprints that were shoe prints, but they were these strange footprints that they'd never seen before. And even up to the 1970s, when Daniel learned the instrument himself, he had gone out and became an engineer, and then he came back home and started learning his family's tradition. That history stayed even then. While Sheikh Amala Jabate, he's what they call a griot, and he's a court musician. So he's a musician that has to know, you know, the I think maybe 100 generations of history. And he has to keep that in his mind. And there's a whole apprenticeship that goes with it. So just to even have these two types of musician in the same room really brought this energy that had not been there before, because, you know, the philosophical place of where each of the instruments sat, the ngone is, that's the court instrument, and they will always try to elevate that higher than the accompting, which is a folk instrument. So they were, both of them were even having a philosophical issue about, well, we don't know, you know. Sheikh was like, I don't know about the accompting being the one, and Daniel was like, I don't know about that, and it was Mali and Gambia. So since y'all been studying a little bit about Africa, that those two places have always had some politics going on with it.
Mm-hmm. I mean, one of the things that came out when you put those instruments together, though, is it allows you to understand the roots of the banjo in a larger way. One of the things that I had to first figure out when I started looking into the history of the instrument was this peculiar thing, which is that, so in the history of musical instruments, there's a very important influence, of course, of North African instruments in Europe, right, through Iberia, through the kind of period of Andalusian period, from the 7th century to the 14th, 15th century. And actually, European lutes and guitars and all those instruments all come from North Africa. They're brought in from North Africa, and they become part of European musical culture. And we know that in the Iberian period, there were instruments that had string, that had skins on them like this. We find engravings of them. But at some point, that kind of construction basically disappeared from European musical instrument making, right? And that's kind of interesting. It's kind of a puzzle. Actually, it was Pete Ross, who was another person we all met at the Black Banjo Gathering, who's an amazing artisan who makes gourd banjos based on old engravings and paintings today. And it was he who actually suggested the answer, I think one answer anyway, which is that part of the problem for a long time of building banjos was just how to keep the skin, which contracts and moves with the weather and cold and rain. And when you attach that to something like a gourd or to wood with, you know, metal, it can be very, very difficult to keep together, right? Now, in the 19th century, people developed this kind of technology, which was needed to hold skins on drums, which is a metal technology with tightening rods and so forth, and that kind of solved that problem. But until then, in the European climate, having skins on certain kinds of instruments was really difficult, right? So he kind of suggested that as an answer. What's interesting, of course, is that in Africa, meanwhile, the construction of a resonator with a skin was incredibly widespread, right? So it was on the ngoni, it was on the accompting, it was on hundreds and hundreds of different instruments. Now, in Africa, there is a bewildering number of different harps, lutes of all kinds, a lot of distinction up until this day, right? Different constructions in different contexts. Even in a particular group like the Hausa, there might be 10 or 11 different types of lutes. They're in Central Africa, they're in West Africa. What's interesting, though, is that consistently there is this construction with the drum head, right? And it's that, I think, that kind of enables us to understand that one thing that would have been familiar to lots of different Africans in the New World would have been something about that sound, right? So in some ways, both the accompting and the ngoni, which don't really live together in Africa, came to kind of live together in the Americas. So part of trying to figure out that story, of course, was looking at the kind of earliest traces of this instrument. These instruments kind of come to, we find little traces of them little by little, and we find little bits and pieces, and part of the work of the project was just bringing them together, and I'll show you a couple of those pieces. I should also say that for those of you interested in African instruments, there are these incredible collections from basically colonial museums in Paris and Brussels, where all these instruments were collected in the Congo and elsewhere. And there are these collections with hundreds and hundreds of different instruments from the 19th century. And they're pretty amazing to see. What's also striking about this history is that we know very, very little about the very origins of this, right? If you think about it, Afro-Atlantic music is one of the most important cultural epics of in the modern world, right? The kind of music that came out of the slave experience has transformed our, you know, our sonic experience. It's a global sound. And yet the stories of how it came to be in its first, in its earliest iterations are hard to come by, right? Mm-hmm. So one of the earliest sources is that we have about this is from someone named Hans Sloane, who was a naturalist who traveled to Jamaica in the 17th century. And Sloane has in his book something really remarkable, which is a series of transcriptions of songs that were played in Jamaica in the 17th century. And this is actually one of the only transcriptions we have until the 19th century. So we've started talking about a project that's built around this. We, with collaborators at Duke, we created a website. Now it's called Musical Passage. You can visit if you'd like. I'll just play one. What we wanted to do here was just analyze this one page. This is literally just one page in this book. All of the information about these songs is contained on this one page. Each of the songs is named after basically an African group or ethnicity, Angola, Papa, and Coromanti, which is the word for Akan. I'll play one of these Coromanti tunes because it's one of the most fascinating ones. We just wanted to interpret these. We're hoping that other musicians will begin to interpret them. But you have here this little glimpse of some of the first meetings. And the key to this is that what you see here is what we'll be talking about a lot today, which is that musicians had to kind of gather together to create new sounds that connected different African traditions, right? So here's first one of the Coromanti ones interpreted. There's actually three pieces of music here that were Akan songs. I won't go too much more in depth in this, but there is more here on the site that you can read. I'll play one more of these songs, which is the Angola version, which is a vocal song that we did with voice and banjo. I'll just say about this is the reason this document is particularly interesting is because Sloane basically says that he went to one of these gatherings and he asked one of the best musicians there to transcribe these. And we think this person was probably a free person of color, a free person of African descent, who had European musical training but was also connected to these traditions. So in a sense, this is also one of these early musicians who kind of wrote this music down for us. Now, we were talking earlier about this question of the connection with Africa. I often show this image. This is an image of an instrument from West Africa, from Sierra Leone, and there are a couple of these. These are harps that seem to have been built in the 18th century to actually look like the shape of a ship, right? And it goes back to a little bit to what Vaughan was saying about the story of the accounting. Obviously, the history of the slave trade kind of haunts West Africa as well as the Americas, and it seems like there were actually instruments made perhaps as a way of kind of perhaps connecting from Africa to those who were exiled on the other side of the ocean. And when I think about the kind of first origins of the banjo, I sometimes return to this Derek Walcott. This is a piece of a poem called Homeros, where he tries to describe the transatlantic slave trade and this kind of scattering of peoples and their kind of reuniting in the Americas. He writes, so there went the Shanti one way, the Mandingo another, the Igbo the other another, the Guinea. Now each man was a nation to himself, without mother, father, brother. Yet they felt the sea wind tying them into one nation with eyes and shadows and groans, in the one pain that is inconsolable, the loss of one shore. With its crooked footpath, they had wept not for their wives only, their fading children, but for strange, ordinary things. They cried for the little thing after the big thing. They cried for the broken gourd. And I say in the book that in some ways in the Americas, the banjo was like growing a new gourd and creating a kind of new instrument. Now, Now I want to talk a little bit about what gave the banjo this capacity to do it. And again, we've talked a little bit, we were talking about this, a song called Po Black Sheep, actually, where you see the kind of ways in which different traditions were brought together in this instrument. What I try to argue in the book, essentially, is that if you have, try to put yourself in the situation of an enslaved musician in a place like Jamaica, or South Carolina, or Haiti in 17th, 18th century, right? So a musician would have been often in a plantation world in a context in which people really needed music, right? In which music obviously was understood as important for religious process, for funerary rituals, for just, for celebration in some contexts, for solace, for connection. Music obviously is very vital, right, to every civilization. So the musician would have to kind of find a way to play music for that context, right? But also to play music for a context in which people had very, very, very different expectations of what music was. The difference between, say, a Central African and a West African, even the difference between some Akonting versus Ngoni in West Africa, these were really different worlds, right? So the kind of plantation context forced people together in a context in which a, sort of some new sonic vocabularies had to be generated. And what's interesting about the banjo is that the banjo kind of pulled this one force, which was this question, the skin over the resonator, and used that, right, to also connect. What I argue in the book is that this instrument emerged, because this instrument is not like any particular African instrument. It sort of broadly draws on a number of them to create a new form. So the instrument kind of was a way of pulling that together. And that's something that I think we can continue to hear even in the songs and in the traditions that Dom continues.
Absolutely, and with you mentioning the Akan people, one of the first proverbs that I heard that really resonated with me was a proverb called Sankofa. And Sankofa is an idea of taking the elements of the past without going backwards, taking them into the present to draw you into the future. And a lot of times you'll see it depicted either as kind of a heart with sort of a lightning bolt in the middle of it to show that it's a serpent, or you see you tend to see it as a bird that's flying forward and it's touching its beak back on its back wing, showing that it's taken those things from the past and brought them forward. And so the banjo is definitely, it's Sankofa, the 200%, in the way that it, like Laurent said, it wasn't an instrument that existed beforehand, but it had to take every instrument and it had to be recognizably African when it was played and the banjo rung out. And then also it had to teach a new lesson, it had to teach a new language, it had to teach a new way of being. Well, this one here, Po Black Sheep, this was actually recorded for the Library of Congress by a third generation black ethnomusicologist out of Fisk University, John Work III. And he searched high and low to try to find a black banjo player who still played in the tradition, and by the 1940s when he was doing this, he had a lot of trouble finding somebody, but he came across one guy who played on the streets, and I think he was from, I want to say he was from one of the outer towns, I want to say it was like Hermitage or somewhere like that, one of the outer towns of Nashville, and he played this particular number that I took a fancy to, and I incorporate a lot of things I had learned from hearing Shekamala Jabate and people like that in the way that just melodic elaboration. But I'll show you. I'll play it about five times through or something like that and show you a little bit of how I modify the melody. So this is how it sounds. Just the straight melody is. Thank you.
So one of the things I think that's been so vital is to create these lineages, right? I mean, you all worked with Joe Thompson and kind of worked with older players from North Carolina. These recordings, a lot of musicians, Layla McCallough, who's playing Haitian banjo music, for instance, is learning from recordings. You're putting out these new recordings. So one of the things that I tried to do in the work was to create also like a longer-term, deeper lineage to see if we could figure out some of the early enslaved banjo players. We could find their names, we could figure out who they were. And I learned at the Banjo Battery, and it's actually what pushed me into writing this book, that there was this whole Haitian side of the story, this whole Caribbean side of the story, that was the earliest information we had about these banjos. So I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the Haitian sort of ancestors that we have to this, and some of that music that you're also putting out on the.
Well, before we jump out of the States real quick, I just want to show everybody kind of one example of this. And Laurent's book has this great section talking about how a lot of the strings that used to be on the banjo were made with the hair from the horse's tail. And to me, that sparked this idea in my head, because you know, I do this particular thing in school shows just to kind of show how powerful the banjo is. So without pressing any notes down, you'll recognize this melody. So this is all open strings. And so, where's that from? The races, but what race in particular?
Kentucky.
Yeah, there we go, Kentucky Derby.
Yeah.
Okay, awesome. Now, so that's the theme song for the Kentucky Derby. Now, if you look deeper into the history of Louisville and all the different places that in Kentucky that form into Bowling Green, Kentucky as well is like that, you'll find a very strong African-American influence on the culture, because there's a big population there. And also, a friend of mine got me hip to the idea with the Kentucky Derby. I don't know if a lot of people know this, but the first 10 Kentucky Derbies were all black jockeys. It was only black jockeys for the first 10 years of the Kentucky Derby, and then it diversified as it went. But if you think about horses, you think about slavery, Reconstruction, and all that sort of stuff, the idea of black people on horses and why they were so good with the horses and why they were considered the top of the line for the jockeys, that gives you a lot of history. And the fact that this... And so when I read Laurent's book and he starts talking about this particular jive of this one particular slave making his banjo strings out of horse's hair and twisting them so that he could have strings, all of a sudden there is a deeper history and a deeper backdrop that is, it's almost like a tapestry that's been half painted. And when you add certain elements to it, the tapestry becomes vibrant and the colors all come in, and all of a sudden you have this very elaborate picture of our culture in the United States. But that's the sort of thing I would play for folks in general. But Laurent's book has a lot of very interesting points of entry to the culture of banjo. And while we work in sort of fragmentary work, it's very much musical anthropology that we work with. And for in my own career, one of the things that I realized very quickly was that almost 0%, I'm going to say 1% of the music has been reinterpreted twice. There's always been one interpretation or one piece of documentation that has defined the music that we think about for each of these parts of the banjo's history. And to just be able to read about the different angles that the banjo's taken and all the different, its different forms that it's taken over the years, and to be able to reanalyze it with the knowledge of what this backdrop means, was something that I found was desperately needed. So of course my previous group, the Carolina Chocolate Drops, that was one of the big things we did. I mentioned that I was into these songsters, and the elder musician Joe Thompson, who we based our group off of, when I heard his music, all of a sudden these songsters weren't anomalies in the blues world. They were the point in which this earlier culture connected with what we now know of as blues and jazz and all of those things. It had a strong culture of string band music, and that the fact that there were these
these musicians that played every type of music, and then of course they had to narrow it down, recorded music came out, all of a sudden you find that there's a bigger picture that hasn't truly been analyzed in a as much as it could and should be.
Mm-hmm. There's actually, so one of the earliest sources we have of an African-American banjo player in Virginia is actually this man named Titus, who used to play at the Richmond bass track. And it's pretty fascinating because among his songs, if we think about even this connection, possible connections to the griot history, one of the songs was actually a narrative of Gabriel's revolt in Richmond. So in 1818, there's an African-American musician who's playing at the racetrack in front of crowds, mostly white often, who actually tells the story of this revolt, right? So kind of keeping these things alive. And I think that's kind of something that I found in particular, looking at some of the Caribbean sources, that it became very clear how fundamental the banjo was to kind of keeping memory alive in a certain way. Now, historians, of course, a lot of the information we get about slavery comes often from runaway advertisements, right? Advertisements that were posted that describe that are basically looking for an enslaved person who ran away, and often provide these really extensive descriptions of them. That's how people have been able to reconstruct the history of the banjo and other instruments in North America. And in Haiti, we're able to find a couple of runaway ads. I know these are a little bit difficult to read, just showing them to sort of give you a sense of them. There's two that describe, so we're able to find these names of enslaved musicians. One was named Pompey, it says this in here simply that he played the banjo very well. It's called the Banza in Haiti, and is he's sought after by his master. The second, though, from a little bit later, in a sense is even more interesting, because it describes this guy named Kawe, who they describe as a great banjo player, a songster. I want to put this in here. It's called a chansonnier, so a banjo player, a chansonnier, a songster, and then a term called enjôleur, which is actually an early modern French term for basically kind of a magician or a spiritual leader of some kind, right? So suggesting that this man had a kind of capacity, you know, in some ways a religious capacity, and they're looking for him. So it gives a sense of that. The other thing I meant to mention for this earlier one is it describes that this man here plays concerts on a series of plantations that were owned by one master, right? So he's kind of circulating a particular zone. I've also been able to try to find images of the banjo. It's kind of interesting because it's a little bit evanescent in the early period. But there's a couple of engravings we find in Haiti where you can see in the corner or somewhere someone playing a banjo, right? So this is actually just I know these are a bit probably hard to see from the back, but this is just an image of a town in Haiti, part of a series of engravings. But in the right-hand corner, just over here, you can see a little group of dancers. And when you focus in on it, you can see that to the right here, there are actually two musicians playing banjos, right, for this little group. And similarly, there's an engraving here. This is actually just a drawing that was meant to be made into an engraving of the burning of Le Cap Français in 1793 in the middle of the Haitian Revolution. It's an incredible document with like hundreds of figures in it. But again, in the bottom right-hand corner, there's a little group of people playing music. And I know this might be hard to see, but there's a man sitting on a drum and playing the banjo as well. So from these, we can kind of start to see that this was not very noticed that many by observers, but it was really present, right, in all these kind of ways. And I'll just end with one kind of case that really, I think, shows us the relationship between the kind of spirituality and the meaning of the banjo and how it's kind of stretched out over time. And it connects a bit also to the way that Don has been connecting now to these Caribbean traditions. This is an instrument that I first learned about at the Black Banjo Gathering. It's a kind of a remarkable story. In the 1840s, an abolitionist named Victor Chocho traveled to Haiti to sort of report on the situation in Haiti. And while he was there, he collected an instrument, a banza, and he brought it back to France. It was in a museum for a while, a musical conservatory. It was then boxed up at some point in the 19th century, broken into two pieces, stayed in a box until 1997 when a new musical instrument museum opened in Paris. And one of the curators found the two pieces and figured out that they snapped together, right? Now this was incredibly important because actually the number of gourd banjos, like the old gourd banjos we have, is incredibly small. There's basically two, maybe three in the world, right, from before the 19th century. So this was a big discovery, and people kind of rushed to look at this instrument, and Pete Ross now make replicas of it. Now what's interesting about it is that it has engraving on the neck. And a lot of instruments in Central Africa in particular have engravings on the neck or are sometimes fully carved to look like a human, or else have various forms that kind of, and it's basically a way of reminding people that the music is a link to the spirits and to the ancestors. When I first looked at this, a lot of us just started looking at this and trying to figure out, well, what was this? What does this symbolize? Right? You can kind of see there's kind of maybe a face. But when I started looking into sources from Haiti, I also found this really interesting indication of another enslaved musician. It's just a little description in a planter memoir that describes an event on a plantation a few years before the Haitian Revolution where there's a dinner, and there's two, what he calls public musicians, to which I take, I think, kind of professional musicians who are enslaved. Their names, though, are really interesting because they're stage names, they're kind of songster names. Their names are Trois Feuilles and Grand Simon. And when I saw that, I really stopped, because Trois Feuilles, for those of you who are familiar with Haitian culture, there's this kind of anthemic song that's in voodoo, but also in folk music, called Trois Feuilles. And the symbol is three leaves, and the idea is, the symbolism around it is basically a kind of symbolism about memory and healing, and the connection between memory and healing. In Haiti, there's a music called troubadour music, that where the banjo is kept alive. There's actually quite a big, rich banjo tradition in contemporary Haiti. And one of the songs they often play is this song, Trois Feuilles. I'll just play it for you, for just a little bit of this song. You can hear that's the banjo starting out. The song itself says, it's fairly simple, it actually says, three leaves, three roots, if I gather together them together, I'll remember, if I drop them, I'll forget, right? And actually, in this version of the song, later goes on to describe the slave trade itself, right, in the crossing. But you can also see the way that the banjo, in this case, actually really holds together the song. It's kind of interesting, it kind of meanders through it, this style. Now, it took a while, and this is why you need to present to audiences all the time about your work, but it took a while in showing this image to various people and showing both of these pieces before making the connection. And it was someone, I wish I knew who they were, actually, raised their hand and said, doesn't that look like three leaves on that banjo? Isn't that the easiest interpretation? And suddenly I thought, wow, right? And I say in the book, this was a novel, of course, I would connect all these pieces. This was that musician named Three Leaves, his banjo, right? His song. I think what's more likely is what we have here is just one case that we see a lot of music, right? Where a symbol, the idea of these three leaves, the idea that music is a way of connecting and remembering and maybe healing as well, is kind of kept alive on this instrument. So that's, I think, where I will kind of, we'll now open it to discussion. Although I think I wanted you to, maybe you wanted to play one last song. Because what I think is so important about Dom's work is that it's continuing this tradition, right, of these songs that go really way back. We're talking about a 300-year history. And the way in which I think in your music we really get a sense of that, these strands coming together of history as well. So.
Absolutely. Well, it was funny just listening to some of the things you were mentioning. You know, some of the stuff I found out, and I'll just mention a couple of general things for everybody as they continue their own studies, is there were quite a few, slavery changed forms when the English started incorporating it into their culture. And so there were many enslaved people who knew French, Spanish, Portuguese, or all three. And even though they did not know English, that did not mean that they were mute. And so that's a thing to just throw out there. One of the early pieces of historical documentation when it comes to talking about the banjo is the Stono Rebellion in South Carolina. And that ultimately led to the outlawing of drums to the people of African descent. So the enslaved people could no longer use drums, so they made things like, they used the banjo, they used the tambourine, buck dancing, a pat and juba, hand rhythm games, any of that stuff. So you could keep the same rhythms without actually using a drum. And that's also something that's very distinctive when you get into the Caribbean and Africa, and then of course when you get to places like Cuba where they've retained a lot of the drum traditions, the music sounds different. So that's something that makes American music unique. But when it comes to religion, so this is one thing I learned recently. I watched a great documentary called Many Rivers to Cross, and it's Henry Louis Gates. It's on Netflix, check it out, it's amazing. And one of the things that they talked about is religion. So so the Spanish owned Florida first, and one of the things that they did as a way to really disrupt things in the United States is that they put out a call that said, if you're Catholic, or you convert to Catholicism, we will free you. Spain will free you. And so there was a group of Congolese slaves that were up just north of South Carolina. They heard about the call, and that's what started their uprising, and they started making their way down the coast, and it led to this revolt. And so thinking of things like that, especially with like the three leaves idea, where you have a sort of religious connotation or a magician or a spiritual leader of some sort being incorporated into this culture of banjo. So those are just a couple of things to think about. This song I'll play for you is a song called Pole Howard, and it was originally recorded by the great songster Leadbelly, Hughie Ledbetter. And this is a song that when I first heard the interview with Alan Lomax that Leadbelly talking about this song, he mentioned that this was the first song that the first Negro fiddler freed from slavery sang. This was his main song. And then I made it into a little medley with another song called Gwanna Dig a Hole to Put the Devil In. And that's one that Leadbelly learned when he said he was still in prison. He had been incarcerated at one point. But it was a song that all the boys could sing out in the field because they didn't care for the boss, you know. And so it was a song that they all could sing when they saw him coming, but he didn't necessarily know that they were talking about him. So they'd say, oh, we're going to dig a hole to put the devil in. And so that's both of the songs here. So let me play a little bit of this one. This is one I had the great fortune of playing at Carnegie Hall and at the tribute concert to Leadbelly. Oh, and I incorporated a little bit of the banjo technique of another person that Laurent talks about that we don't have time to speak of, is Pete Seeger, who took the same idea we're talking about of Sankofa, and he applied it in the modern world, where he took the old ideas he had learned, incorporated them into his banjo, and led a whole generation, several generations, in a direction of trying to find a new voice for themselves. And so in Laurent's book, in the later half, he talks about Pete Seeger. Of course, we have to speak of him now that since he's passed away, he passed away in 2014. And, you know, he used to be the one that would tell his own story, but now we have to tell his. But anyway, this is a song about kind of that the movement. This is a song about movement.
Oh, how it is dead and gone.
we do have some time for questions, I think, or maybe just requests for more songs.
I will also mention that Laurent's book has inspired me so much. I've recently been working on an album on Black Cowboys for Smithsonian Folkways, and in addition to doing that album, which is my own one, they asked me to compile a record for their classic series. So Folkways has a series of classic blues, classic religious songs, or whatever, what have you, and they want me to do a classic banjo volume 2. And I use Laurent's book as kind of the jumping off point for me, because the study of the Caribbean banjo and how it fits into the whole context of the entire movement from Africa through the Middle Passage and all of that culture is still very, very new. And Laurent's book is the first one to address it wholesale. And so I found it just a wonderful way to jump out and incorporate all these different parts of the Folkways catalog, because they feature a lot of wonderful Haitian string bands. With Harold Corlander, did some amazing stuff with the Haitian string bands, Pete Seeger's albums that he did for Folkways. They've also done some really wonderful compilations on ragtime banjo as well, so I incorporate kind of a little bit of the entire history of the banjo within that CD. So keep an eye out for that. But Laurent's book is a great inspiration for anybody who wants to know more about the banjo in a holistic way compared to just the facts. Just the facts. It's something bigger than that.
Thank you.
Questions? No questions. Okay.
This is for you, Dom. Do you mind talking a little bit about the Music Maker Foundation and your work with it and what it's about?
Absolutely. Well, you know, the Music Maker Relief Foundation is a nonprofit organization that helps out traditional Southern blues artists and roots artists of all sorts. And I got to know them a little bit after I moved to North Carolina, originally in 2006, and I've been on the board since 2009. Actually, part of my travels to get here, I was in Ann Arbor, Michigan, and made my way down, and I did a benefit dinner with them. But one of the things that Music Maker's done musically, outside of the mission work that they do to help out these traditional singers that have fallen on hard times, or they come from very rural parts of the United States that sees poverty that a lot of us could not even believe, you know. It really emphasized the communal aspect of music, particularly in the African American communities, because a lot of these guys, like one guy in particular named John D. Holman, who I've known for a long time, he lives in Durham, North Carolina. And when I met him, see, I'd heard his CD, and I thought to myself, this is the baddest dude that's ever played the guitar. And so I'm originally from Arizona. I hear him for several years through the Music Maker CD he put out. And I get a chance to meet him through Tim, the founder of Music Maker. So, you know, I told him that I was into the records he put out. And he's like, oh, you want to meet John D? And I said, oh, yeah. You know, and I'm thinking, again, you know, when we see how music is disseminated out to our culture, we think that all the artists are very far away. But in folk music, there isn't that big of, there might be a single white picket fence in the way, you know? So John D came and he drove down, and it was so amazing to get a chance to see his world. You know, I got to meet him, and then later I'd go to visit him at his house. But see, he was known as the guy who fixed the lawnmowers. See, people didn't necessarily know that he did music at all. But he had been to Africa, Asia, through the State Department, and he'd been all over the world playing his music. But in the culture of Durham, where he was living, he was known as the guy that fixed the lawnmowers. And nobody necessarily would have asked him if he played music at all. And so Music Maker is a very important organization, because it really got me understanding that there is kind of a couple of layers that you can pull aside, and then you can find some very amazing people who have lived amazing lives. Of course, I'm reducing John Dee's biography down a whole bunch, but he was just has done some amazing things, but was just a normal guy in the neighborhood, you know? Nice question. Great question. Another question, maybe? Another question? Yes.
Yeah, I can see the connections that you're making with texts and artifacts, but what about playing styles? How are you seeing playing styles with continuity from Africa to now?
Well, that's a
Laurent could probably talk about a little bit more. The main parts that you find the true connections in American banjo playing is when you start seeing the Blackface Minstrel Show. And even though it is a entertainment form that is very complex, and also was, part of it was, actually it makes me think about Daniel Jota. I went to a talk with him. Since it's lampooning blacks, it can be very disturbing, but at the same time, the musical culture that grew around the banjo through that entertainment style, a lot of people wrote down the music, and so there's a lot of music that hints at the things that Laurent's talking about. We didn't go into the whole section on that, but those are the entry points that in which both of us started on. You know, the Black Banjo Gathering, it brought together about 24 black banjo players who were playing the banjo in whatever capacity. It brought together the banjo scholars who were interested in the what they call the stroke style, which is the blackface minstrel style that grew out of the 1850s. Then there were people that played old-timey music, which is another culture that grew simultaneously with the blackface minstrel show. There was the folk version, and then minstrel shows are like the pop version of it, to break it down that way easily. But that's where stylistically, where you start seeing a lot of stuff is when you get into that era of the 1840s, 1860s, because it was just in the black community early on. And then by the 1840s, and of course in the course of the Civil War, it became an instrument that was described as a wholly American instrument. Mm.
I mean, so one of the reasons we're emphasizing this Sloan piece is like literally the only place where you have transcription, where you have something that you could use to figure out style, right? And there's actually a lot in that transcription that's very helpful. I mean, it's a very, intricate about sort of the motion of the notes and so forth. But of course, it's true that there are some paintings that show, maybe the way this hand was held and things like that. But otherwise, it's like really frustratingly kind of silent, right, in a certain way. And then the great irony being that then the minstrel phenomenon generates a huge number of books to teach how to play the banjo that have all these banjo tunes in them and descriptions of style. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, minstrelsy is so saturated with ironies, but one of the ironies, of course, is that it's all predicated on the principle that the white musicians are presenting them as authentic interpreters of black music, right? And they all play up the fact that they learned how to play from African-American musicians, particularly Joel Walker Sweeney, who's one of the founders of this genre, right? So nowadays, there's a lot of people trying to go to those early minstrel books and see if through that you can get at the tradition. Of course, the other way is to think about contemporary traditions. 20th century African-American musicians, are they carrying on a tradition? Do you put it alongside African? But of course, all of that from a historical standpoint is complicated by the fact that we know musical styles always change and affect one another. None of this has been happening in isolation, right? So the story of jazz in New Orleans, which I write about in the book, is really interesting, where the banjo was really central as well. But so you can look at Jamaican mento and Haitian troubadour music, and all of them are long-standing traditions, but they're also always hearing each other. So which is just to say, it's a complicated question. Sometimes I think it'd be wonderful to be able to say, like, well, obviously this style comes from Africa, and you sometimes sort of hear that. But at least in my sense, as I dig more into it, I think it's much more difficult to know what's influencing what. And that's part of the point, right, is that our culture, all banjo playing is black banjo playing on some level, right? The culture is infused with these kind of roots. And there's a way in which so it's present in all kinds of ways. But that's been hidden because, as you mentioned, in the 19th century, there's a whole wholesale effort to try to unhinge the banjo from its black past. You can kind of track that effort. Like, it was a cultural project to make the banjo America's instrument, partly by making it no longer a black instrument simultaneously.
And then also at the same time, with people moving away from the old ways of the South and not being country, the banjo is a countrified instrument to the full degree. So that idea, the banjo playing was really pushed back into the local musicians who wanted to play. Like Joe Thompson, for example, he played since the early 1920s with his brother in North Carolina in Mebane. But he was a rare exception to the rule because people his generation were playing Blind Boy Fuller and all the guitar-based blues singing. And so that was that's also a thing that's kind of working against the banjo when you look into the history as well, is just that it just was out of style, and it wasn't, again, it stopped becoming the instrument that was leading you forward. It became an instrument that reveled in the past. And you know, the minstrel show, most of it is all about nostalgia. And so, you know, nostalgia doesn't work as well when it comes to black culture. It's a very different type of nostalgia, you know what I mean? You go, you know, you keep going back, you'll end up in some very, very particular situations that the minstrel show, of course, kind of, it smooths it over and says, hey, it's all right, we're all back here and it's all good, you know, but in the culture itself of the African-American community, that's always been kind of a double-edged sword. So even as I've re-embraced the banjo as an African-American musician, you know, the first time I talked to the Taj Mahal, the great blues musician, he was so surprised to see a young black person or a young black group that was actually playing this music, because he himself had been one of the very few. And, you know, everybody else that played was more or less influenced by Taj. When you meet people like Guy Davis or Otis Taylor, they were all influenced by Taj, and he spawned his own generation of banjo players. So the fact that we came in with a slightly different way of handling the music, he was just blown away by that. But that's kind of how it's been with the banjo.
There is an intriguing set of things, like about the influence of mento on early reggae playing styles, for instance, and the influence of the banjo on blues playing styles. If you think about the right hand, like the, so I think there's a lot of spaces where it kind of affects. I should say also that Taj Mahal, it's Taj Mahal's fault that I wrote this book too, because this all began because I just wanted to learn how to play the songs on Taj Mahal's album, and so I bought a banjo, and then I had to ruin it by turning it into an academic special.
And that was the Take a Giant Step and the Old Folks.
Yeah, that album, which is incredible. If you're looking, that's an incredible album of, and Taj was one of the few people who went, and he went and found, you know, older African American musicians in the South, and learned from them. So he, in the 60s and 70s, was the only one doing that. He played once in Durham, North Carolina, and he pulled out his banjo. And in Durham, when people pull out a banjo, people clap. So I love playing here. It's like one of the few places where that happens. You know, in Washington, you see people just run. There was, I think, a question here.
I was hoping you could discuss where your, especially your right hand technique comes from, and how it differs from, I think, how most people, you can see people on the, especially the American folk band, just like the girls' clubs, on yourself. And also, the way you decided to play it, like a force for me,
Well, as I mentioned before, I started playing the drums first before I started playing guitar, and then I played banjo after starting the guitar. So in that way, my technique has been influenced by, you know, finger picking in that sort of way. The four-string banjo, I got into it because, see, a friend of mine let me borrow a banjo that was a five-string, but he was also a guitar player, and he didn't like that little string, so he just ripped that thing out.
That's what the Haitian musicians do, the troubadour.
Yeah, you still see it. If it's the four-string style, it's just the fifth string's not necessary. And so I had this banjo for a while, and I mean, I was playing any old thing. I was playing like Mean Julio down by the schoolyard, because I at that point I only knew how to play guitar, so I'd do... And again, I do a kind of a Caribbean... Mama, mama, roll down the bed, So I would mess with the banjo and work with the things that made it such a unique instrument, particularly the fact that it doesn't draw, you know, the sustain is decent on it, but what makes it great is that it's a pop that comes in the sound. So there was that. And then when I learned how to play clawhammer and all that stuff, I didn't have anybody teaching me how to do it, so I just had to figure out ways to play it. Again, being a drummer, I just figured out, you know, to me, I thought of this as my snare drum, and then this was my bass drum. You know, and I just started with just very basic ideas of rhythm, because then you... a lot of different techniques that I could apply to the four string. I never learned how to do scrug style, because that is claw hammer, you can kind of get around it without a fifth string, but scrug style, you need five strings. It's just kind of the mechanics of how the banjo works with that particular style. So I just had to learn how to piecemeal a bunch of different styles together. Of course, New Orleans jazz has always been a thing that's really been wonderful. Manny Sales and a lot of the early Preservation Hall banjo players really influenced my style as well. So it's kind of a composite of a lot of different stuff all at one time, which at the time I thought I was an interloper, but when I went to the gathering, everybody reassured me that making up your own style was actually good, you know, and so I kept going with that. And I've done slide banjo, I've played banjo Hawaiian style, you know, I've done a lot of different types of stuff, just experimenting with different ways to make the banjos have a unique sound.
It's funny, because I played percussion, I played congas in a salsa band before I took up the banjo, and it was interesting, because when I took up the claw hammer style, the right hand made a lot of sense, you know, whereas like trying to learn scrugs, for me, would be like theoretical physics for me, it's just completely different, but something about the rhythm, you know, the fact that you can have a kind of beat with the right hand,
absolutely.
I think, but I think a lot of musicians have probably brought different pieces. Johnny St. Cyr, you know, played the guitar, and then was asked to play the banjo, so he took a guitar neck and stuck it on a banjo head and continued playing the guitar, basically. But you know, and a lot of the New Orleans stuff, which is phenomenally interesting and hasn't been written about enough, I think, is really interesting. And there's an incredible archive at Tulane, the Hogan Jazz Archive, that has you know, photographs and interviews with all these players. But they too, it's because it's such a rich amalgam of different musical styles being brought to the banjo in the early 20th century. I was going to say too that the kind of you know, the strange thing is Tony Thomas, who is one of the organizers of the Black Banjo Gathering, has a pretty interesting theory just about the rise of the guitar, which has less to do with the kind of distaste about the minstrel show or other kinds of things, but rather just has to do with the question of sustain.
Yeah.
And that he argues that when certain kinds of vocal singing styles that just needed more sustain developed and became appreciated. So it's kind of interesting, because he sort of makes the point that, right, if African Americans had to give up everything that somebody you know, racialized or made a racist comment about, there would be few things left, right?
Oh,
so
so
the banjo was held on in certain ways, but it also has to do with, it worked for dance styles, the kind of stuff that Joe played, right? Sort of fiddle, banjo, driving dance, social dance. It's interesting in Haitian music, because in Haitian music, the banjo music is very prevalent, very important, and yet almost never recorded. Right? We did an event at the Schomburg with I and Layla McCalla, whose album I also recommend, who's interpreting a lot of Haitian music, who played with the Chocolate Drops and is now also. But it was interesting because she played this music, and a lot of the Haitians in the audience say, like, this is our music. You know, this is like what you hear at a wedding, it's what you hear on the street, it's what you go to a party and hear, but you never hear it in the States, right? And so it was kind of. So it's interesting, there's a way in which styles, you know, the way that the music recording has worked has meant that some styles almost get erased.
Absolutely. And, you know, one thing I thought about with the minstrels, you know, a lot of them, they called themselves, you know, the style, like kind of like a thespian is a name that you use for an actor. They called themselves Ethiopian delineators.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
delineators,
you know, I kept wondering to myself, like, why Ethiopian? Why not, you know, Dahomian, which is kind of like West Africa, the earlier name for it. I kept wondering, like, why were they using Ethiopian delineators? And when I found out that Ethiopia was the only African nation that wasn't colonized, all of a sudden the idea that this is the blackest of the black music, we do the blackest, you know, the authenticity factor of Ethiopia became its own thing within the blackface minstrel show. Like, that was something also Burt Williams, the early blackface performer, actually not black, he was from Nassau. Again, even now, the history doesn't account for the fact that, see, Burt Williams performing in blackface being from Nassau is different than a guy from Alabama performing in blackface. It's just, it's two different cultures that you gotta switch. But Burt Williams, my point being, Burt Williams' plays, the first one was called In Dahomey, that was his first play, became a hit on Broadway. And then the second one was Abyssinia, and that one was another play that was talking about Ethiopia, and that was the name of the Ethiopian Empire, was Abyssinia. And so these guys incorporated these ideas into their plays because they got to see some African dancers. And so these guys were comedians, blackface comedians, and they thought to themselves,
well, these white guys are doing this delineating of us, or what they interpret as African. Why don't we delineate our own characters based on the aesthetics we choose? And so they made plays around these characters of their interpretation of African mannerisms and African song styles. It became very big, and it led to James Reese Europe having gigantic banjo orchestras in Harlem, because Burt Williams and his partner George Walker, they were James Reese Europe's mentors, and that led to the Harlem Renaissance with people like James Reese Europe. So it's a very interconnected world of the arts.
Yeah.
You know, because even though they were blackface, they were looking to uplift the race with each of their performances.
If you know someone who really hates banjos, you can scare them to death with a picture in this of James Reese Europe's orchestra, which has like 50 banjos.
Yes.
Carnegie Hall, 50 banjos. But James, what Europe basically said, if we want to create sort of orchestral music that's truly African-American, we have to have banjos. You know, we have to have a section of banjos. And it really drove, people kind of loved it at that period, right?
So, and then unfortunately, you should. Oh, sorry.
I was going to say. Do we have to? Am I supposed to stop at some point? I just because yeah, we could go on forever up here, but
there's one or two more questions. Why don't we take those?
Okay. Sorry, I just realized it's 6:30.
And I'll also mention that the blues, being a vocal style, it clung to the guitar, but that's why the banjo isn't a blues instrument, and you rarely hear the banjo playing blues because it doesn't have that sustain, like Laurent mentioned as well. So anyway, little things to think about, because when you start studying the music, you'll find that there are just little things in the backdrop that will really, it'll just... turn your head backwards and forwards again. Yep, in the back there.
Yeah, hi. Being from Arizona, Donald, are you aware of any presence historically of the banjo in the Western United States?
It's funny that you mentioned that, you know? My most recent album I'm going to be doing is on Black Cowboys. And, I didn't know this growing up, but about half of the cowboys who settled the West were black cowboys. And they worked with the Mexican vaqueros and the white cowboys in settling the western parts of the country. There's actually a story of one guy, his name was Charles Henry Williams, and he was from Tucson, and he was a banjo entertainer that was the mascot for the Negro League baseball team in Tucson and in Nogales. And so they have a couple of little tidbits of him, kind of like the stuff we've been talking about with the banjo, just little tidbits of him being a part of this baseball team. He started the first all-black mining company in Arizona, and he did. He ran for sheriff at one point. I don't think he got it, but there were just like three or four little things about him. But he was known as Banjo Dick. And at that time, you know, the early version, what Dick meant was like you were the top of your game, and you were. You know, kind of like we would just say you're a player now, you know, he's Banjo Dick. He was the guy that was doing it. And so there are little pieces of banjo history in there, but it's, you got to think of it as like, if you think of the plantation system of the South migrating west in the first waves of settling the West, a lot of black people move in that direction along with it. Or if you think, we tend to think of Alabama, Georgia, and Mississippi going up to Chicago and Milwaukee, you got to think of Texas, Arkansas, and Louisiana moving west to LA. And so every stop along the way, you'll find African-American communities. And then, of course, once there were railroads, then the Pullman porters and, you know, people moved around a lot more than we give them credit for now. But you could jump on a train and you could go to towns like, if you go on I-10, it still has the same sort of stuff. You know, you go from Louisiana to Baton Rouge, and that takes you to Beaumont and Houston, and then it takes you to Galveston, and it takes you on that lower half, and it takes you all the way to L.A. with no particular obstacles in the way. And so that's where a lot of these black cowboys started up. But yeah, there's just fragmentary stuff here and there of banjo players, but that's the one guy I've heard of, is Banjo Dick, Charles Henry Williams. Mm-hmm. Great question.
Any more questions?
One more question?
Well, then let's thank our extraordinary.
Thank you all for coming.